Hello again. As you know, I am Eli, the computer guy, and we are doing yet another Coffee with Geeks with Phil Charnock, head of communications for SwapBots. They do augmented reality toys. So I thought I'd have them on since augmented reality is the big, cool new thing. So thanks for being here.
Hello. Thank you for having me.
Yeah. So the first question I always ask everybody when they come on the show, so we know who they're talking to, when you call yourself head of communications, what does that actually mean?
That sounds really quite posh, doesn't it? Yeah. It basically means that I do all the talking. So yeah, I'm here to basically try and verbalize what the incredible geeks in our studio here are coming up with.
Oh, okay. So is it the same as like a CMO, or do you have a CMO besides you?
Yeah, no, we certainly don't. There's only 13 of us, So I think I actually do multiple roles. But yeah, CMO, that'll do. That sounds quite good, doesn't it? That sounds like I should be paid more. I like
that. Like, oh, yeah, that sounds like a raise. Okay. So how did you get to your position then? So head of communications for like a startup company, like what's kind of your background?
Well, it's a long story, so you'll have to bear with me here. I'll start it at the point where I was on the phone to DJ Jazzy Jeff and Will Smith. We'll start there. Okay. That's a natural place to start. I was actually doing, I've got to fill in somebody who were interviewing them. And I kind of got a taste for writing and said, yeah, I quite like this. Started writing. Writing obviously moves to the web. And I found myself working on more and more high-tech projects. And SwapBots, here we go, these old SwapBots behind me, and not actual size. And yeah, basically, I think that's about the fourth project I've worked on with roughly the same team of people. There's always been a couple of us that have worked on different projects together. We've always had a hunger for interactive technologies, immersive technologies. And yeah, I'm just the one who hasn't got the skills to design or code. So, you know, here I am talking about it.
That works. So I mean, a lot of people are interested in like working in tech companies, but not necessarily doing the tech work. Did you just kind of back yourself into this? Were you trying to get into tech, or you just wound up doing it?
No, I wasn't particularly trying to get into tech. To me, I always imagined that video games were made by crazy people in lab coats somewhere in Neo Tokyo or something. And it wasn't going to be something that I loved video games, and literally were playing them right from when I was so small, playing on a Binatone console, which anybody who's old enough may just about remember one of them. Only had Pong on it, and that was all you needed back then. And I never imagined myself getting into it. It's not that I didn't want to work in it, but I just thought it was so far out of reach for me that I would never get involved. But as it happened, on my doorstep, I'm here in Liverpool, that's where we're based, and it just happened that an awful lot of really good video games are being made here. Of course, Sony ended up with their base for PlayStation Europe was in Liverpool, and all the Formula One games and the Wipeout games, Lemmings, all sorts of different games came out of this city, a relatively small city. And it's something that I didn't know was happening right under my nose, and when I found out, I wanted to be a part of it.
Oh. That's cool. That's cool. So you're in England, because I had the idea. I talked with somebody. I thought you were in Ireland. You're in England then?
Well, that'll be Andy's accent. I'll blame him, because Andy is originally from California.
Okay.
Moved around here near Liverpool when he was 16, I think. And he's one of our co-founders. So there's Andy and John, who are two co-founders of SwapBots. Mm. And yeah, he's ended up with this mashup accent that is definitely mid-Atlantic. And, you know, Ireland's kind of in the middle of the Atlantic or to one side of it.
I guess so. Okay. So then when we're talking about SwapBots, because what is like SwapBots as a company? So you have 13 people and you're in Liverpool, but then I saw on your email address, you have like Draw and Code. So is SwapBots the actual company, or is Draw and Code the company, and this is some kind of project of that?
Well, to go, I won't go quite as far back as phone calls to DJ Jazzy Jeff, but to go back about 6 years, we set up Draw and Code, and Draw and Code's an immersive technology studio. So we make VR experiences, AR experiences, projection mapping. So anything that puts the user right at the center of an immersive 3D interactive world. And we're quite far ahead with that sort of technology. I'm not saying we're as far ahead as, you know, a lab in a university somewhere that's working on this stuff. But, you know, we're first in line for the DK1, for the Oculus Rift, when, you know, the Kickstarter went live, we were there putting our money down and going, yeah, this is the future. We were working with augmented reality from slightly before, actually, we set up Draw and Code. So yeah, it's Work for Hire studio, and we were working with some great clients, but there comes a point where you say, okay, we've made a lot of products for people. Now it's time to really put our money where our mouth is and make a product ourselves, which is what SwapBots is.
All right. So then, okay, so now we got to the point. Now we get to the point in the show. What is SwapBots then?
What is SwapBots? Just a bit of practice. The rest of that was made up. So yeah, SwapBots, they are these little toys. The ones you see behind me are big cardboard cutouts that will fall over if there's a gust of wind. But yeah, they're basically toys that are brought to life with the magic of augmented reality. There we go. And yeah, as you can see, the simple piece of plastic, you know, we're not talking about a very expensive toy. We're talking about something that is, you know, there's no technology inside the toy, and we get a mobile device. So any iOS or Android device will bring them to life. Now, of course, we've seen mobile augmented reality before. You know, it's been knocking about for many years before the current generation of smartphones with touchscreens even. But it's really coming into its own now. And particularly, obviously, we've seen the success of Pokemon Go. But we do something a little bit more sophisticated, because the platform that powers that is a few years old, still very good. I've played enough Pokemon Go, so I'm not going to knock it. But things have moved on, and not necessarily with the devices just yet. There are some incredible devices coming. But yeah, with SwapBots, we wanted to make the most of AR. So we get the physical toy, we bring it to life. And so it's like the video game has escaped from the screen, like it's in the room with you. So you can head to swapbots.co.
Okay.
Got to do the plug, I'm afraid. Yeah. And go and check us out there. You can pre-order the toy. We've had a successful Kickstarter, which was very good. The toys are still available to pre-order at the moment as well, and you can check them out there. It's not really worth me doing a demo down the camera. I don't think it's quite the same. So there's videos there, and you can see what it's about.
So you've got those little square toys, and you've got I get the toy sort of, and I get the augmented reality. What are you doing with it though? Do you just look at the toy through your mobile phone and it shows you something different?
Well, it's a little bit more to it now. So basically, yeah, the toy will come to life. And the first thing you notice is obviously, you know, this isn't kind of a marker-based AR that's flat, that's 2D. This is three-dimensional, which is so cool in itself, because obviously it means you can literally hold the toy in your hand. You can touch it, you can pick it up. And that is unusual, not quite unprecedented, but unusual. And you can also swap pieces of the toy, so you can pull it apart, and there's a head, a body, and a base, and each one has different attributes in the game. There's then a few different game modes. The kind of core game we've done the most work on is a battle game mode. So you typically have two swap bots, two people playing either locally or over a network, and they would battle each other. You basically press different parts of the swap bot to make it do different attacks. There are special moves, there are power-ups. There's also environmental elements that we kind of build around it. So it has its own little base, little environment hub that you build around it, put items around it, that power it up, that protect it, or just look cool.
Huh, oh, that's cool. So there's that. So it's not just the toy. So there's a whole game that goes with it then.
Absolutely, yeah. And it's aimed mainly at children. So we're looking at 6 to 12-year-olds. But to be honest, that's probably what Pokemon Go is aimed at. And I've played it a little more often than I should have missed.
That works. Okay. So you're just using the handheld, like tablet or phone. You're not using, whatever the hell those goggles are or whatever. You're just holding it in your hand.
Absolutely. We have developed for those sort of devices. We've developed for an awful lot of devices. Been working with Occipital Merge recently on proper mixed reality devices. And we've had SwapBots running in HoloLens as well, which was fun. Very expensive way to run a little tiny plastic toy. But yeah, we wanted to go for mobile augmented reality because from a business point of view, that's a huge market. Obviously, I don't need to tell you just how big it is. And anybody who's got a young child will know that they just pick up tablets immediately. So my young lad, he's only 2.5, so he's already able to surf through YouTube, select videos. He doesn't type anything in, obviously, but he knows what he's looking for and can find it, which is astonishing. How natural it is to use. And so, yeah, it's kind of perfect for our market, perfect technology. One day we would like to have it, hence our experiments with it in various kind of mixed reality headsets. We definitely would like to embrace that sort of technology or the 3D sensing technology that's starting to creep into phones, into Lenovo's Fab 2 has the sensors. Apple are obviously gearing up to something like that. That's definitely something we'd like to do, but we want this to be able to reach kids, and they'll typically have hand-me-down tablets. So my little fella's got an iPad 2. That was the first iPad that I got hold of. Yeah. I gave that to him, gave me an excuse to buy something new. But it means the cameras, you know, they're not always the best in those older tablets. I think people haven't quite realized that point. The camera would be used the same way it would be in a phone. So we have to kind of design this with that in mind. So we've got flat sides, we've got high contrast, we've got lots of details, intersecting lines, all the different things you'd see from a kind of good AR marker that tracks really well. Yeah. We've tried to put in this to try and kind of make it totally suitable for the mobile technology that it will be used in conjunction with. And that's a result of our experience. That's because we've not just gone into this. This isn't our first AR project. You know, it's something that we've had a lot of experience of and we really know how to do well.
That's interesting. So why did you pick like toys? If you have all the experience with augmented reality, especially that, I'm not sure that would be my first thought of what to go into if I was going to do a business off of augmented reality. Why that?
Well, what would you make? I'm really curious now.
I don't know. You know, I would be thinking more something along the whole, the commercial environment. You know, like if you could put up, I don't know, like signs or messaging. So if you had your industrial employees, your security employees walking around and they needed information, you could pull that up and look at some kind of something along those lines.
I like that. Yeah, I like that. I'll write that down. I'll do that later. Okay. No, right. What you're describing there as kind of a more of an enterprise solution where you're getting something quite sophisticated by the sound of what you're proposing there and something that has kind of quite a prosaic and practical use. Now, we've done a lot of work in that sort of field, and we were exhibiting at AWE, the Augmented World Expo, which is in San Jose every year, and has been for quite a few years, 6-7 years, I think now. And we were exhibiting there, and we turned up with augmented reality Space Invaders was the main thing we were showing off.
Oh, that sounds
cool. Yeah. Just the kind of measure of us, where we just go, right, what silly things can we do with this? Because we have clients where we've worked on big infrastructure projects, or we've worked on health and fitness projects, we've worked on with architects. Architects really get this technology. They're really sus when it comes to interactive 3D stuff. And I think it was just an excuse where we said, look, we're just turning up to showcase our work so we can do a game. You know, we can just have some fun. And we turned up at that show not knowing what to expect. It was the first time we turned up at that show. And we exhibited incredible companies, some incredible products. But there was nothing like what we were doing. We were just about the only kind of really fun, silly, irreverent use of this technology. And we did a similar thing next year. We turned up with something that was a mix of AR and VR, but loosely based on Pac-Man. And it was something that, again, we turned up and said, wow, we're just about the only game here. And we saw the potential for games, the potential for toys, because augmented reality can make anything into an interactive, animated surface. So for us, it's a really tactile technology. It's something that enables the world around you to change. And I think that's just, for us, it just kind of instantly resonated that that's something that's perfect for a child's imagination. I always imagine my toys talking to each other, coming to life. You know, Megatron really would be having a strop with Optimus Prime, whatever. And it was something that, you know, it just felt natural for us to make games. And it was actually at the first AWE that we attended, the 2014 one. But John and Andy were in a bar in San Francisco afterwards and just chatting through this and saying, well, a lot of these uses were enterprise uses. There was uses for designers and there was uses for kind of people in factories so they could work more efficiently. Yeah. And then we were turning up showing this game. So we kind of said, well, we know that this is a really good use, this technology. Let's try and make something of it. So the guys just started sketching what became SwapBots, and essentially they sketched this. It really wasn't far away, the kind of size, form, the ideas. Lots has changed, obviously, in the little details, but essentially they came up with that idea while having a drink immediately after the show, and they were kind of inspired by seeing all these enterprise use of it, just saying, well, we're in a crowded marketplace with what we're doing. You know, we've done that for a lot of clients, and clearly, especially when you go to a more international show like that, the first such show that we'd exhibited at, I think that kind of makes you go, okay, we need to do what we feel is right here, because there's already people doing what we're doing, and we feel this perfect for toys, perfect for play. And so, yeah, the guys came back with the idea. Everybody here instantly went, yes, we get it. It started as an R&D project. It got a bit out of hand, to say the least. You know, it started out as each year we challenged ourselves, make our own little in-house product, something really cutting edge, really innovative. And this one just didn't seem to leave our consciousness. We made it and just said, no, this is a really good thing. And the more people we showed to, the more momentum it got. And we just in the end said, yeah, let's make this for real.
Hmm. So how did you do the beta testing? I mean, how do you make sure kids actually want to use this thing?
Well, you pay them to say nice things. That's, we tend to find that works. No, and well, the first hurdle we had, I say technology, not a problem. I won't say not a problem. That's the, you know, luckily it's late at night here. There's none of the developers are in, so I can say that. But you know, it's something that we have got a handle on, and that's me showing confidence in them. You know, I'm not saying it's easy, but I'm saying they managed to make it look easy sometimes. So we knew we could handle the technology side of it. We produced one or two video games before as well, so we're kind of quite familiar with that sort of side. But the big thing where we went, okay, how do we do this, was we had to make some toys with no budget, basically. So there was a makerspace in Liverpool, not too far from us, and they offered, I think it was on a Tuesday night, you could print one thing for free. So obviously these toys come in three pieces, so we could print one piece at a time. So it took 3 weeks to make one toy, and then you'd find they didn't quite go together properly. And then the big thing that was then the big issue was, how do you print on them with something that would work in AR from a 3D print? So we bought our own 3D printer. We have so many hundreds of swap bots lying around the office, various iterations, various different ways to connect them, different styles of printing. You know, we had kind of, you know, that's, I can't think of the material now, but the ceramic style of 3D print. And again, that's very heavy. It's very jagged. And you just picture, you know, older siblings throwing it at, you know, a little dumb tantrum, and it's not going to come out well, is it? No. So, you know, we're having to experiment with all these different things. It was so hard to print on. We had to go to a manufacturer to go and print on them for us in the end, and kind of get a bit enterprising with that, because it was a really difficult thing to do. So yeah, we had to kind of prototype these from scratch. So at first it was just us tinkering around late at night, after hours, coming up with these weird and wacky, wonderful designs. And then we kind of went to the kids. It was a bit back to front, and we kind of went, okay, because we didn't realize it would be a product we would sell at first. We went, okay, we're just doing this as the latest way to test ourselves, to keep ourselves, you know, ahead of the game, coming up with new ideas. And when we realized it had legs, we said, right, we better get some children on the case. So the first children were a few of us here are parents, so we managed to get a few of our own kids in to try. Then we started to gather all their friends around and start to do more and more. But now we've been exhibiting at shows that kind of heavily family centric, you know, they've been, you know, mum, dad, the two tech savvy kids. Yeah. And it's been incredible. So there's now been, apart from the official testing and the original testing with friends and family, now it's been thousands of people trying SwapBots, which is quite incredible.
What have you found a change about the product since the kids have been playing with it? Like, what, like with the original iteration, is there anything that you've modified because the kids told you that change something different?
There's been quite a few things. I mean, there's little things, perhaps won't show up so well on the camera, but we have this kind of central piece where there's two protruding pieces. At first we had each block of it had a little protruding piece for them to attach together. It was found that this was a really clear way, because we want them to go in this order, head, body and base. And because the animations have to be based around a certain thing, and it look a bit weird if heads are on upside down and there's two pairs of feet on. So first we kind of started experimenting with that. So it was the form factor outwardly hasn't changed much, but there's little details inside the toy. If you saw every iteration, you kind of understand. We did a few papercraft ones as well. That was mainly to test the technology. But in terms of gameplay, that's been very fluid. It's been something where it starts off with what we want, and that isn't necessarily what children will want. The one person said to us, said something like, you've probably got it right when you hate it with a children's product, because they're not necessarily looking for the same thing in a toy and game that you are. But I don't think that's always the case. I say, I still like Lego, so do lots of children. So that's not necessarily the case at all. But I get the point, is that it, you know, it might be something unexpected. So yeah, the game has kind of really changed. We have kind of gone to having more happens on the table now at the moment with it. So we're you know, really excited by augmented reality. And the wow moment of the game is when you first scan the toys, they come to life. People go, wow, didn't expect that. Yeah. And so we wanted to keep that going. You know, you've got things like Lego's Nexo Knights uses augmented reality. You've got toys like Skylanders, Disney Infinity, Amiibo, etc., that use obviously NFC connections to get the toy into the game, but a lot of them will just be scan to play interactions. So we started out like that, and then, you know, had a more conventional video game, and we just realized that the wow moment was when you scanned it. So we wanted as much as possible to happen on the table, and we've re-experimented. We've done more and more and more with it. It started out with just a figure comes to life. Then we started to build a little world around it. That wasn't in the original plan. And we start to go, no, this is really cool. Once we know where the bottom of this toy is, chances are it's on a table being played with. You can start to build around it and do other things. Yeah. And so, yeah, it just started to get more and more ambitious what we were doing. We've developed all sorts of mini games as well, because children have short attention spans. And I think multiple different forms of gaming keeps them kind of playing within your game. And I think that's a really handy thing to do to mix it up. Again, we were just focused on a battle gameplay. Mm-hmm. Now there are a few different modes of gameplay and a few more that we have kind of, you know, as a concept stage. So there's been lots that has changed. It's literally today, I've got whiteboards just by me here, kind of drawing new gameplay dynamics and everything. So it's still a moving target at the moment, gameplay.
So did you bring in any kind of like child psychology company to help you with this? Because the problem that I see a lot of times with things like augmented reality focused on kids is that the adults get so excited about it that, yeah, you know, you bring in the kid every once in a while, but they're not really part of the process. Did you actually make the kids part of the process, or was it just when you kind of remembered them, you went back and said, how does this look to you guys?
A bit of both, actually. We did make them a part of the process, but as I say, it was a little while after the process had started. So yeah, now the feedback from children playing the game is massively important, and it's the first thing that we speak about. Whereas at first, when it was a pure R&D project, it was mainly driven by us just going, yeah, that's cool. That was kind of, you know, that was the main thing. If somebody said cool, then we're probably doing a good thing. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's kind of very, very different now. We've also got experts who've come in from various different fields. So we've got this sounds posh, just like my job title does. We've got an advisory board. Mm-hmm. So we've got somebody who's an AR expert, who's vice president of Euphoria, which is the platform that we're building, you know, SwapBots around. We've got somebody who's ex-licensing expert at Disney, Lionhead, DreamWorks. Mm-hmm. So again, they know what these big toy companies are looking for in the toy ideas and game ideas that they invest in. And so, yeah, we've also got incredible partners with Creator are our manufacturer. So we're no longer having one piece at a time made on a Tuesday night for free. We now have basically one of the world's largest toy companies producing it for us. A company called Creator, based in Chicago. Not a brand name that's that well known, but they've been behind an awful lot of incredible toys over the years. Particularly Skylanders, they're the manufacturer of Skylanders. So again, Activision developed Skylanders, but they are manufactured by Creator. So yeah, we've now got all sorts of people kind of inputting into what we do who know an awful lot more than us about the space we're going into, because software, animation, these sort of areas are our background. Yeah. So we've tried to bring in people who understand toys, they understand manufacturing, they understand licensing, and that's really has informed the product big time.
That's cool. And so with the SwapBots as they are, I mean, do you imagine when you're looking at that, do you imagine that's something like Monopoly, like theoretically 50 years from now, or is this more, this is what you can do now, so it's more of a proof of concept of what you really want to do in 3 years?
This is now. This is right now. Literally, I mean, the potential of mobile augmented reality is pretty much untapped, really. When you think about the successful apps that are out there, really the only kind of multi-million user apps would be Pokemon Go and Snapchat, would be the only real two. You know, there'll be little bits and bobs here and there that are successful, but really they're the big ones. But you look at the technology in them, Snapchat has invested massively in augmented reality, so they are starting to move further and further ahead. And they had a different type of geofilter was revealed the other day, where it's kind of more in the 3D space around you. So they are getting more and more sophisticated as time goes on. But you look at something like Pokemon Go's system is at least 7 years old. Obviously, it was in Ingress, used it. And before that, it was in Heritage sort of app. Hence why some Pokestops are in some really weird places, and you get those headlines of, is it appropriate they're at the Holocaust Memorial? Well, that's because they were just using their old database, these locations. So for us, perhaps this is why we played so much Pokemon, actually. The nearest one's in a really old pub just down the road here. We've got a pub that's, you know, a couple hundred years old, beautiful but old pub. And there is a Pokestop inside it. So yeah, so it's something where I just feel this technology hasn't really been tapped into. There won't be many times you will have seen a 3D marker-based augmented reality product. Certainly one that comes apart, can be customized. So the term will be multi-marker is what the term will be. And multi-marker technology is not used that widely at all. And the technology is there. It absolutely is there today. You look at, I say, we partnered with Vuforia, who've been amazingly supportive and helpful, and look what we're doing. Yeah, real thrill was at GDC. We had our toys appearing in Vuforia's keynote and appearing on Unity's stand. So that was a real thrill for us that they said, you know, that wasn't us going up and pestering them like Andy pestered you at South by Southwest. That was genuinely, they wanted to do that. You know, the kind of Vuforia featuring was just a huge surprise to us. We didn't realize it was going to pan out like that at all. So I think that the market needs to catch up with the technology. This technology is here now today. Most phones, most tablets can deliver this. I say we tend to be limited more by a camera than by processing power. We obviously can't test for every single particular Android device out there, but we'll test for a lot of things. And generally, that's not the problem. You know, it can be done. It's just that people haven't done it yet. And I think that's the case with mobile development generally. I think there's so much can be done, and you're always seeing new ideas for apps and new ways to use a phone. And I think that's really augmented reality to be in this sector, to see it moving so fast. And it's at a stage where, particularly with the commercial release of VR last year, where we started to get headsets in shops. So we started to get PlayStation VR, Oculus Rift 5, Samsung Gear being given away, Google Cardboard's costing $10 or $20. It's something that has really exploded. In terms of users, it did explode. You know, there will be millions of people using VR now. Yeah. Not, it won't be the big platform the way mobile is, but it fired up people's imaginations. It got a lot of news stories, a lot of headlines away from, you know, the mainstream press. My parents, who are late 70s, knew what this technology was all of a sudden last year, thanks to Pokemon Go with AR and thanks to these headsets with VR. And it's firing people's imaginations. They're coming to us. You'll be in a, you know, in the line queuing for coffee or something, and somebody will, you know, get chatting to you and say, what do you work in? Oh, software. And they'll just straight away, you know, if you say VR, AR, they'll go, well, I've got an idea for this. And, you know, it's such, but it's that stage. And if anybody worked, we were working with, you know, mobile development with apps during the earlier days of it re-exploding with the App Store. Yeah. And again, people just had ideas. They just wouldn't stop telling you them. And it was so exciting. As soon as you mentioned you worked in that, they had an idea. And you just had an idea just then, you know, took 5 seconds to think about it. And you had a really good idea of how to use AR. So I think it's a really exciting technology. It just hasn't been exploited fully yet at all.
So for like the head mounted displays, how long do you figure before those are affordable?
Affordable, it can happen in no time really, because we've been experimenting with Merge VR, and they've got their fantastic Holocube. Similar concept to what we're doing. It is a 3D six-sided marker. Ours is five-sided. There's nothing on the bottom, but six-sided marker that you hold in your hand. It's probably one around here somewhere. We've got a couple. Yeah. And fantastic. So the idea being that you feel like you're holding a hologram in your hand. And we exhibited with them at the, I think it was the 2014 AWE show that I mentioned in San Jose. They were just sat on a little trestle table next to us with their kind of foam headsets. And they had a bit of a controller thing as well, like really well thought out, and kind of VR and AR headset. And yeah, they've had all sorts of investments since. They're flying now, and Holocube is just incredible. And that's affordable. The Merge VR headset is, I don't know what it is in the US, but it's £29.99 in pounds over here. So probably, you know, not much more than $30. And it's a high quality, it is a kind of cardboard style headset, but it's got the window where you can pop it out so your camera can look through. So you can start to have, using your mobile phone, a kind of head mounted AR experience. And then you've got Occipital with their incredible structure sensor. And now they have a bridge, the bridge headset. with 3D scanning technology in it. So I think it's something that is just around the corner. It's just about to happen. But I'm not sure whether the headsets will be kind of, if they're paired, something like what Holocube do, where they pair it with a physical item, they're aiming it at children who are willing to experiment. They're willing to pick up and play with things and give it time and you know, do all sorts of weird and wacky things. They don't mind looking silly with a headset on their head. Put your headphones on, once upon a time that would look odd to people. And people say, oh, isn't it strange with you know, a headset on for VR or AR? But for me, it's something we get used to it, you know. And I think, if I haven't answered the question, I'm doing a good kind of political bit here, aren't I? But we'll give it a decade, but it will be available, and I think children will be using it first. I think toys really do lead the take-up of new technology. You know, if you look at IBM's Watson was in a dinosaur in 2015, and it certainly wasn't anywhere else in your house. Barbie, you know, had a virtual assistant as a physical item rather than just, you know, an app on your phone, before Amazon was selling you anything like that. So often the take-up of new technology, toys can be, especially these days, can be a really, really big part of that. In terms of physical kind of an alternative control methods for video games, toys are doing a great job of that at the moment. You've got Beasts of Balance, another UK game, fantastic project. That was partly funded by the UK Games Fund, which is a UK initiative to back really promising video game startups, and they're backing us too. So that's, and they've now, you know, they're absolutely flying Beasts of Balance, really, really incredible product. And then you've got another UK product called Light Seekers, which the kind of name makes you think of Skylanders, but it's more advanced. You can pick up the toys as you start moving them around. Say if you go, woo, I'm flying them around like this, they'll fly around the screen as well. Really incredible. And there isn't much kind of in your home that's using the technology in this way. And I think augmented reality big time will be driven by children to a large degree. I really do think it's a technology that the reaction it gets from kids, they get it and they will popularize it.
That's an interesting idea then. So with you guys, so did you start this on Kickstarter or did you build it first and then go to Kickstarter?
Sorry, I just lost you there. But yeah, we did start it on Kickstarter. I heard that part. Yeah, basically, it was kind of, we started the business a little bit before. I say the idea was developed from 2014 onwards, but real proper, okay, we're going to actually start to manufacture this. We needed backing to do that. Yeah. So we got a small amount of angel investment, got the UK Games Fund support that I just mentioned. And we're also part of the Hacks Boost Accelerator in the States. So that's SOSV. Venture Capital Fund, every year invite a certain amount of businesses to either set up shop in either San Francisco or Shenzhen. We went for San Francisco, but ironically, the toy is now being manufactured in Shenzhen, so maybe we should have gone there and, you know, we'd have seen the toy being produced, which we did fly over there, but, you know, we'd have saved the flight if we already had a base there. So yeah, Hacks have been incredible. They have primarily, they're a hardware startup accelerator, so they understand what we're going through. The weird thing is, it's kind of quite hard for us to consider ourselves hardware when we just make some plastic. You know, there's no wires in this thing. There's no batteries in it. The hardware we're using is a phone or tablet. But essentially, that's a really, really important thing because we're selling a toy. So yes, our background is software. Yes, that's where the sophisticated stuff happens. But ultimately, when you go into a store, you're going to pick up a toy. You're not going to be going to an app store, the Play Store, and buying an app. There's no in-app purchases. There's no in-app advertising. We want something that's parent-friendly. We don't like that sort of thing when our kids are using apps, so we didn't want to force that on other parents. Yeah. So instead, you go into the store, you spend a few dollars. These are, unfortunately, Kickstarter's in pounds, so it's they started at $14 on the Kickstarter for a pack of three plus the app. Yeah. And it's something that we felt was really, really important that we kind of have all these partners in place before we started pushing forward and doing the Kickstarter. And also Kickstarter for toys is a tough thing to do. So we didn't take an easy route with this. And no Kickstarter is ever easy, but the big thing is that toys are a kind of product that is bought really on instinct, on a whim. It's something where a child wants the toy immediately. You know, maybe Father Christmas will delay that a little bit. Maybe a birthday coming up would delay a big toy. But for a smaller toy, they either want it or they don't. There's no kind of, hey, this will be produced and you'll receive it in 5 months' time or whatever. You know, that's not quite how kids work. When we were exhibiting this last year, we spoke to a chap who distributes toys and gadgets to really big retailers.
Yeah.
And I've got to do the accent, so you've got to excuse me, but without the accent, it is not as good. But he described what SWATBots are. And he said, hey, do you know what these are? He was from New York. I don't know if that sounded Irish then or what it sounded like. But yeah, he said, you know what these are? These are shut-up toys. I went, shut-up toys? What? He went, oh, you know what it's like? You know, mom's in the supermarket. She's got the kids with her. She gets to the counter and it's like, you know, a toy that's $6, $7, $8. She can afford that. The kids are making a load of noise. So she just picks it up, hands it to him, goes, here you go, shut up, kid. And that's basically, it's a shut-up toy is kind of what he described it as. So that's, it's something you buy on instinct. It's something that you kind of don't necessarily plan with toys. Also, you know, it's a relatively small outlay and a lot of Kickstarters are larger kind of, you know, packages available. So it's a lot easier. Maybe not a lot easier. You've got to sway people to part with a lot of money, but you don't have to reach as many people to do that. So yeah, we did set ourselves a bit of a challenge with doing that, but it was just the last piece of the puzzle for us. We'd had some funding. We'd won these awards. We'd been part of the accelerator. We've also got some retail sales agents in Minneapolis. So we get to visit there and, you know, kind of go in all sorts of big, strange, anonymous, cool buildings. And it's something that we wanted all this in place before we went to retail. And we felt the Kickstarter was a really nice way of bridging the gap with the last bit of funds, something where we could market ourselves, where there was a story to talk about as well. So not only does it get the last part of the development of the game kind of done and get more toys produced than we would be able to afford otherwise, it also means that we can tell a story. We've got a platform to go out there and say, look, this is who we are, this is what we're doing, this is why we're doing it. You can head to swatbots.co and check the videos and see all that. So you can see us telling that story. And it's something that I think without a focus like that, if we just went, hey, this is a cool toy. And just kind of doorstep people the way we did in South by Southwest with yourself, I think it needs that kind of, it needs everything coming together. So the Kickstarter was about many different things. It was not the start of the journey for us, but it's been a really important stepping stone that we had to get funded on that. That was so important.
And how much did you get funded on Kickstarter?
The final figure, well, our target was £25,000 and we were a bit over that. I can't remember what it was off the top of my head. It was about 103.4% or something like that. So just over it, basically. So yeah, now you can still pre-order. If you go to our website, there is pre-order thing you can see on swatbots.co. Yeah. So you can still get almost all the packages, not quite all the packages are available with Kickstarter, but you can get your hands on the toys and that's the important thing.
That's pretty cool. And so how did you advertise your Kickstarter? So a lot of people think, I'm just going to put my thing on Kickstarter or I'm going to get money. I mean, did you have a marketing plan to push people to Kickstarter or what did it yes. just, was it viral?
Yeah, it was the main marketing plan was to find you in South by Southwest to tell you about it. No, it was the big thing with these toys, you know, ideally toys are marketed via either TV or YouTube. YouTube is a hard one to crack. TV is expensive. So both those things were not really a part of our plan. You know, if they happen, that's nice, but it's not going to be the main plan. So yeah, we had to basically get people to see the toy in action. I don't think it's quite good enough to read about it or to hear some idiot talking about it like me. I think you do have to see it. Preferably you have to have it in your hand while it comes to life in augmented reality. That's the thing. That's when people go, wow, when can I buy this? And you start to get that kind of happening. So we've been to a lot of trade shows. So we've exhibited at, I'd say, AWE, GDC, CES, lots of other basically shows with three-letter acronyms. So going all over the place, New York Toy Fair, South by Southwest, Gamescom in Germany, which is huge, by the way. 400,000 people go to that. Crazy. So we didn't get quite that many people on the stand, you know. So a lot of it was about getting it out to people. But I've also been to all sorts of little maker fairs and stuff like that where you go, no, this is our audience. Mm. This is the kind of, these are high-tech, tech-savvy families who are really interested in the next new thing, toys that you can play with, that you can learn from, that you can be creative with, you can customize. That's what they're interested in. Yeah. So yeah, it's been kind of grassroots events like that. But a lot of it is, of course, social media-based. So an awful lot of getting it right and wrong on social media. It's certainly a lot easier to get wrong than right. And yeah, it's basically we've always kind of had a half decent social media presence. We've always enjoyed it, kind of communicating with people that way, but we've never had to sell a product. We had to maybe sell our brand as Draw and Code as the kind of client studio. Yeah. So that, you know, we're the first name on somebody's lips when they want to come and develop an AR or VR app or whatever. But it's a little different to saying, okay, here's a product, we need you to buy this today. That's a very, very different challenge. So yeah, we basically had a digital marketing plan that the Hacks in San Francisco really helped us with, but it's still such a tough thing. But there was one or two amazing moments along the way with it. We, you know, you got Project We Love status on Kickstarter. A lot of projects do though. But we also got selected, we're Project of the Day, so we're on the front page. And we didn't pester anybody. There was, you know, something where you imagine, oh, you'll never get there if you know somebody or that kind of thing. And it wasn't, you know, they naturally kind of found it and went, yeah, we like this, and put it on the front. So there's one or two unexpected things that weren't something we hoped for, but we didn't plan for, that kind of happened. It ended up being a bigger boost than our kind of more coordinated planned efforts, to be honest.
And so for the people at home, I mean, like when you're talking about CES and all these things, I mean, I know how much money though it costs. I mean, it sounds like, oh, we flew to CES. So like, can you give an idea of what your marketing budget for this thing has been so far?
Right. To tell you the truth, it's something that we've become very adept at getting funding, getting things kind of, well, for example, we saw you in South by Southwest, so in Austin. Yeah. So that's a very long way from Liverpool here. And we basically won an award from Northern Stars. Basically, it's a thing in the UK. And it's to find the most promising startups in the UK is the idea. And we're one of 10 winners. Really unexpected. We did not think we'd win. It was lovely when we did. It was incredible. And as part of it, we get to fund you for various conferences and shows and events. So, for example, the Next Web conference in Amsterdam, I'm off there in about 3 or 4 weeks. Funded by them. So yeah, we've done all sorts of really cool things with them. And one of them was South by Southwest, but they didn't fund the whole cost of it. So we still had to get creative. Luckily, it turned out that as part of the Hacks Boost program, one of the people whose startups was kind of part of our group that we're going through at the time was based in Austin. So it meant getting an airbed and sleeping on his floor, which is what Andy was doing, which probably why I was a bit manic when you saw him. And then in terms of actually exhibiting there, again, there's a cost to it. So we said, right, we're going to enter pitch competition. So we're up on a stage. So we won second place in South by Southwest pitch competition. It wasn't too bad at all. And again, considering we went in there going, yeah, we'll never win anything. And we came within, you know, a whisker of winning it. So that got us a lot of exposure. But the big thing was an area called Great Britain House, really, really cool thing, exhibiting all sorts of cool, innovative stuff from Britain, video game stuff, Formula One cars, all sorts of different things in there. And yeah, we basically, as part of our prize from Northern Stars, we had, I think it was not even a day, I think it might have been half a day exhibited in there. And they loved it. It had such a crowd around it, so many people playing it, and said that it was a different audience where a lot of kind of fun-loving family people coming in and seeing kind of what we were doing and just going, right, we want to play this. And they just stayed there and didn't look at the other stuff. So we got asked to stay. So I think for just about the entire time we were in Austin, which was a couple of weeks, we were exhibiting there. And so, yeah, that trip didn't cost as much. So, yeah, it's kind of been something where we've just had a bare bones budget with what we've done. And we've been very lucky, very fortunate. And we've had some incredible things. So it's been something where, you know, again, Unity and Vuforia, I was mentioning, we were exhibiting on their stand at GDC. Same in New York Toy Fair, we're on Vuforia's stand there. And the Unity for a space there, we're just being exhibited by Unity. So I think people have seen what we're doing. There's nothing else like it out there. And they've kind of taken a bit of a liking to us and said, yeah, you can come along. And so it's been incredible, really. It's something that should be costing us a fortune. And it's still costing us enough, don't get me wrong, but it's not nowhere near. I can't put a finger on how much it's cost, to be honest, but it's something that is nowhere near what you'd expect for what we've got.
So with all these opportunities that are coming up then, is that because you're British and the British are just, yeah, government's giving you a lot of money, or is it because you're augmented reality and you're cool so people want you so they figure out a way to get you? Like how are you getting these like free trips and all that kind of stuff?
It's definitely the augmented reality thing. Yeah, no, nobody's given us free trips before that. That's for sure. So yeah, no, it's definitely is. It definitely is. I think we're the right product, right space, right time. And tech toys are hot at the moment. And you look at something like Sphero becoming BB-8 in Star Wars, and you look at that. That was, you know, pure, not pure tech products. It was a toy, Sphero. Again, we had one of them. we backed that. We got one of them straight away. And again, Disney then invested in Sphero. And it kind of went from there. And there is a real push from toy manufacturers to stay relevant in the digital age. So toy manufacturers and kind of toy brands are looking at this sort of thing. And we've had some huge, huge brands come to us, not necessarily come to us and offer us a pot of money, but come to us for a chat, which is where, you know, everything starts, isn't it? And that's been really lovely. And they've kind of reiterated, no, you're onto something good here. So I think a lot of people recognize that the technology we're using is hot at the moment. The space that we're going into with this technology, with kind of toys to life, if that's the genre that we fit in, that's a really, really hot market. It's a market that's kind of in an odd place at the moment, but it's still, I think there's still a lot of belief in the toy industry that a physical digital crossover toy is the future. And so I think it's what we're doing. I think if we'd have turned up with a more conventional video game, we wouldn't have had the level of attention, the kind of help, the assistance, or some of the conversations we've had. I don't think that'd have happened. I think that what we're doing, you know, when we're exhibiting this, first time I'd been out to California was last year in 2016, and we had, I can't think of his name now, it's terrible on a kind of techie podcast show, but the VP of Amazon, the guy who was behind Google Glass as well.
Oh, okay, yeah.
I'll blurt out his name in a minute and frighten you. And yeah, it was something that, you know, he would not have come up to us if we were just presenting a relatively conventional video game. He just saw the potential immediately for, he started speaking to us about, you know, the Amazon Fire Kids Edition, the Kindle Kids Edition, which is an incredible thing because you get insurance and a squashy case with it. So it's great if you've got a messy toddler like me. So that's been, yeah, the iPad has been replaced by one of them, and the iPad's back in my hands. So yeah, it's something where I just think we are the right product at the right time. And whether we're the right brand, whether the right team to deliver it, that's another question. I think we are. But, you know, that's my job as head of communications. But in terms of the space that we're in, the technology that we're using, it's really hot at the moment.
That's interesting. So with the people at home, if they were interested in, like, working for you guys, you're developing this type of thing. So what language is, like, when you say technology, what technology are you actually using? What do they need to know to do this?
It's primarily we're making the game in Unity, so C#. Okay. And they've got to know a thing about 3D, really. That's kind of what we're working in. So we'll work with Maya and kind of similar programs. There's quite a few 3D programs that do similar things. So yeah, we've basically, that's the space we've been working in. We've always preferred Unity. We've been using Unity for 8 years or so now, I think, in one form or another of various projects we've done.
So, the whole visual component, is that built into Unity or is that something else?
Well, in terms of 3D models into Unity, make the video game world. I'm saying it so fast, it sounds easy, doesn't it? But it's Vuforia is the augmented reality platform that we use. And that works really well with Unity, and that's no accident. They are kind of collaborating and they are well aware of kind of how to work best together. It's really exciting speaking to both. They're both kind of, both Vuforia and Unity are singing from the kind of physical digital crossover they see is vitally important. It's something that we've worked with quite a few different augmented reality platforms. I won't name them because the fact we've chosen Vuforia shows which one we prefer, and we like them all. But they've been so supportive with us. They've been incredible. So yeah, it's kind of, in terms of programming languages, it's C# is where we're at. But yeah, it's basically a lot of VR and AR development. It is the video game world, really. And not just in terms of the development side, but the creative side. So you start to see, obviously, 360 video and kind of maybe films that are presented within a 3D video game-like world. And we've spent years and years hearing about how video games are behind on narrative, they're behind on cinematography, and they have to look to the film world for inspiration. Man. The film world is going to come knocking at the game world's door. They're going to say, how have you made this first person stuff for years? How have you made worlds with complete freedom where it's hard to tell a story in? How have you directed the viewer? How have you directed the interactions in the direction you want them to go in? And that's now a question that film directors will start to have to ask themselves. So it's incredible, really. It's something where video game, not just technology, is finding itself in odd places. We visited a really big construction firm pitching for a job. We didn't get it. But we visited them and said, hey, you need this. You know, if you could visualize your designs, and you know, we're kind of pitching this kind of AR to them. And amazingly, we didn't expect this, maybe a bit naive. They just turned around, pointed through, you know, a window by us and went, hey, those guys over there. And we looked around, there's Oculus Rift headsets, there's Samsung Gears, all sat there and went, yeah, we've got a Unity team working on this sort of thing right now. And so it's finding video game development skills are being used everywhere. You know, you speak to car manufacturers that will visualize design in a VR headset. I say there'll be architects who will certainly be using this sort of technology, or they'll certainly be using 3D models that can, with some finessing, be ported to this sort of technology. So yeah, it's basically, we're kind of, you know, using a lot of tools will be familiar to video game developers, but it's just the kind of final piece of the puzzle is Vuforia for us, for the augmented reality interactions.
That's pretty cool. So then what's the future? So you got the little toys and the blocks and you can switch them around. So what do you figure like on the 2-year horizon of this product is? What are the next things that you plan to do with it?
Well, in 2 years, we will very definitely, in a lot less than that actually, be at retail and be with some really big retail. So we're focusing mainly on North America because we like it. But also because obviously it's a huge market and it's one that we have connections into because of being part of the Hacks Boost program with our retail sales agents, The Stable. They're putting us in touch with very, very big retailers in the States. We're also the big thing. So that's something that will happen within 2017. In terms of in 2018, what we would like is to start getting some working with kind of licensing our platform to other brands and to bring in licensed IP into our products. So that's conversation been going on for a long time now. These things are never easy. And it's really exciting. There's definitely a lot of brands certainly want something like us. That's for sure. They're very, very interested in the augmented reality space. They really like what we're doing. So yeah, in 2 years time, I think we'll be on to our second, third, fourth wave of toys, hopefully by then, at least designing them anyway. And yeah, hopefully in some sort of way, we'll be working with other brands on creating new products.
That's cool. So when you talk about IP, so obviously you probably own the three blocks connecting to each other. It's pretty specific. Is there any like non-obvious IP that you own? Like when we're looking at that, is there something that you're like, oh, we actually have the patent for this? You wouldn't even think about it.
Well, yeah, we've been looking at patents. It's a complex issue that we have a patent lawyer who's been kind of looking through that for us. I won't say too much because it's one of those questions I don't think I could give you the best answer to. But suffice to say, you will not see many products out there that act as an augmented reality market that are 3D and they can be customized, they can be pulled apart, built, rebuilt, different parts, different toys put together to create different interactions, different experiences. We certainly think we've got something there.
Oh, no. But what I'm just saying is, okay, a few thousand people watch this and go, wow, that's a cool idea. Yeah. I'll create 4 widget blocks that I can connect together and do the exact same thing. Is there anything in that you own?
Yeah. I'll tell you what, there's a reason why there's 3. So if you want to try 4, good luck to you. So in terms of that, it's basically, it is the kind of technology behind it. It is sophisticated stuff. Then obviously there's the brand itself. But right now, in terms of the brand, we're really happy with it. We're really proud of what we're doing. Yeah. But it's something that's for the market to decide the value of that and what that means. It is primarily our use of the technology. It's very different to, as I say, the closest example of a big brand toy would be Lego's Nexo Knights, which uses, you get a Lego minifigure, but that's not what you're scanning in. You're scanning a shield they're holding, so a small two-dimensional marker. That can be pirated. I won't tell you how I know that, but it can. Because it's flat, so it's relatively easy. Video game. We wanted something where you could hold the toy in your hand and it comes to life, and actually to physically feel it, touch it in a way that you couldn't if it was just a flat marker, if it's a piece card. We're still experimenting with that, and that's something that could form a part of SwapBots in the future. But yeah, it's the kind of whole way that we're putting this together. There's loads of little kind of tricks that we've got up our sleeve with what we're making, what we're doing, that we're confident or fairly confident, should we say. I don't want to be too confident about it, that nobody else is doing.
All right. And then so if you're in Liverpool, I guess the question is if you're kind of on the cutting edge here with augmented reality, like why aren't you in Silicon Valley? I guess that's a big question. Well,
we've ended up spending a fair bit of time there. Kind of John, one of our co-founders, he's heading back out there in a week or two. But yeah, I mean, I guess we can't afford Silicon Valley wages, can't afford the rents. It's a beautiful place to live, Liverpool. And that sounds like I'm just being facetious, but that's not too far from the truth, because we have an incredible tech ecosystem in Liverpool. A small one, a tight-knit community. But it's strange, we found you head out somewhere out to Silicon Valley and you see the same faces in different places around the state. So it still feels like a small community, even though the place is bigger than England is or something, you know, California is. We found that out. We rented a car and just went, yeah, let's drive from LA to San Francisco. That won't be too bad, will it? 8 hours later, we get there, you know. We did stop off some nice burritos on the way, to be fair. But yeah, it's something where we have I won't say everything we need here. Funding tends to be a problem. Now, I know we've got some funding, so I'm very grateful for that, don't get me wrong, but you kind of see the sort of ideas, the sort of things that are being done in other parts of the world and getting a lot of funding. San Francisco would be a big, big, big place where, you know, you could perhaps find funding a touch easier. I'm not saying it's easy, but it's easier than getting it here in Liverpool. But even London, London's only just over a 2-hour train ride from here. And it's still, there's kind of a bigger kind of incentive for people to back London companies. They understand what they're getting with London. Yeah. And Liverpool, I say, has this incredible history, not just of video games, but of toys. Meccano, Scalextrics, Hornby train sets, all came from here. Meccano, for me, is the original tech toy. It predates Lego. It had a real strong engineering kind of slant to it. It's not made here anymore. There is still Meccano being made somewhere in the world. But it was based in Liverpool until the late 70s. After that, we had video game explosion. Right from kind of indie games on the Spectrum onwards, Liverpool had a lot of successes for such a small city. And so we've ended up with an incredible tech community here. Yeah. And kind of all the talent we need on our doorstep. So yeah, funding is hard to come by in this city. Yeah. But talent is here. We have some incredible universities. And there's an incredible school focused on video games. A school, not a college, university sort of level, school level, taking in 11-year-olds upwards.
Huh, okay.
That publishes video games to the PlayStation, to PS4. Wow. And that's incredible, isn't it? They produce them in-house and they are a publisher. They have ex-Sony people teaching the kids. I don't mean coming in to do a workshop. I mean they work there. They have a video game museum in the basement of the school. Huh. It's a city that definitely Liverpool is unusually well set up for what we want to do with video games, interaction, toys.
And so with most of the tech companies I talk to, they're dealing with just software, but especially with you folks dealing with actual stuff that you're going to have to ship with Brexit coming up. How are you folks feeling about that?
We're optimistic because our market is North America. That's the main market we're going for. Ultimately, we're going to go global, but to be honest, I mean, I wasn't happy about Brexit on a personal level, but from a business point of view, it's something that we can't really predict at the moment. Not even the government can predict it. You know, it's embarrassing. You know, you've probably seen Theresa May when being questioned on Brexit. Her reply is, Brexit means Brexit. I mean, that's just crazy. Crazy talk. They don't know what it means. That's the irony, you know. And so it's hard for us to get worried at this point. So instead, we were going to focus on North America with this anyway, because of the connections we have and because of the size of the market. And it's an English-speaking market, so it's kind of handy for us, so we don't have immediate localization costs.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Canada may say otherwise, I don't know. And there's plenty of kind of, you know, Spanish speakers and everything who would probably say otherwise. But generally, we could market a product in English and do well still. And so that's kind of a handy starting point for us. But ultimately, yeah, we're going to have to look global. We want to sell in Europe, you know, that's what we want to do. And we don't know what the outcome will be. People might have platitudes either saying we all have to pull together and try our best and all the rest of it. But we don't know what our relationship with Europe will be like commercially. And it's something that we're not going to worry about at this point. We've got a good product. The US and UK are incredible markets for us to be tackling. We're happy with that challenge for now.
That's interesting. So that's interesting also from a tech thing, because it's It's always weird as an American how like focused the world is on us. But so even if Brexit and all that wasn't coming up, if you're a tech company, would you like, is your natural market Europe or the United States? Like if you were just going to come up with just your next, whatever the hell your next product is, you're coming up with your next product. Europe's closer, but the US has got English. Like, is just the US, even though it's so bloody far away, is that just still your natural market?
Oh, it is, especially if you're saying bloody, because that makes me feel quite at home there. That's quite English of you. Yeah, it is. Yeah, it definitely is. You know, as you say, the world does focus on the US in a positive way, but, you know, some parts of the world, not so much. And so, yeah, it's always a focus for the whole world. And for us, we would have been going to the US anyway. You know, this plan was already afoot when June 2016 came along and kind of changed our relationship with Europe. So, to us, there's no doubt about that. I think the challenges of Europe, I think kind of in terms of, you know, if you take away trade agreements and all the rest of it, if you just say the amount of languages and cultures and that kind of thing that we would have in a very small area really, that we'd have to tackle, that would be tough for a relatively small company. And it's something we'd have to tackle, but it depends what product you're doing. I know a chap who kind of just came up with an idea, you know, a guy based in Liverpool, English guy, who just came up with an idea for the Chinese market. Just went, this will suit China, went with it and was really successful. You know, so it just depends what your idea is. You might just say, oh, this is perfect for this market and that's perfect for that market. For us, we just felt that the big thing with the US, we felt that because we look towards the US for technology, right. You know, when you're talking about augmented reality, a lot of the innovation is happening in the US. It just seemed really natural technology-wise. Then you start to look at the big toy and entertainment brands. Again, so many from the US.
Yeah.
It just seemed like a kind of natural kind of arena to be in, really.
That's interesting. And then when you're looking at the EU, because I mean, the whole idea of the EU is that was supposed to turn into a single market. But you being in business, do you see the EU as a market, or do you see France, Germany, Denmark, that all happened?
Sorry, I just missed bits of that. But yeah, the in terms of the EU, as you say, is a single market, kind of in terms of red tape and everything. But in terms of culturally, I think it's very different. I think there is, you know, if you just look around, just think as simple as kind of just us hopping over to France.
Yeah.
And that's a really easy thing to do in the UK. You know, we've got the Channel Tunnel. We can get on train in London. That's 2 hours away from where I'm sat now. And then I can get on another train. I'm in Paris probably an hour or so later. So it's, you know, it's something that kind of physically, geographically, really, really close, but culturally a million miles apart. So, or not a million miles apart, but apart enough that it makes for an exciting holiday when you go there. So yeah, it's something that I think when people say a single market, I think that's something that a real global company would look at and kind of that would be important to them. You know, they're manufacturing a car, they want to be able to export 100,000 of them out of the country and they want as little hassle and cost of doing that. For us, we would look at the localization of something like a video game. I mean, say, let's take the toys out of the equation, just say the app.
Yeah.
So if we were just doing software, there wouldn't be, in this day and age, where software no longer comes in boxes unless you have a Nintendo Switch, then, you know, it's something that you would just literally, you know, just upload to an app store and localization would be the main cost, making sure it kind of suited the language and culture of the market. And so, as I say, that cost will still be the same. You know, that would still be the same for somewhere like Europe. So I think for a kind of small to medium-sized tech-focused company, I think wherever you sell in the world, I think there are the kind of same barriers. I don't think Europe automatically makes it easier just because it's kind of nominally meant to be a single market and just because geographically it's very near us.
Yeah, okay. Huh, that's interesting. So I guess the final question, we've been talking for over an hour already, so I guess wrap this up. Big question everybody always asks, are you hiring?
Well, if you want a job, yeah, I quite like you. Come along. Yeah. right now we are not at this immediate point in time, but watch this space. You know, if we sell a lot of these toys, and you can help us do that, swapbots.co. You can pre-order toys. Then we'll have to, won't we? So yeah, not right now, but we'd certainly like to in the future.
That's cool. Well, hey, you have to send me some of the toys for our little giveaway boxes that I'm doing.
We will do, definitely.
Cool. Okay, do you have any final thoughts for the folks at home?
Thanks very much for listening.
Yeah, it was good. It was good. So, so everybody at home, so it was yet another Coffee with Geeks. Thanks for listening. I will see you all folks at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time tomorrow for the normal show. Okay.